to start with, usually you get an LAQ on this particular topic. That is, you will define the occlusion and describe the various factors which affect the development of the occlusion. So I will go in the same manner. I will try to make it as easy as I told you. Now, occlusion, how can you define it? The best and simplest definition for occlusion is, it is a contact relationship of the teeth in function on paraplegia. Now, occlusion as such, it is a very complex entity because it involves many different systems within it. Like, for example, elevations and depressions which are present on the occlusal and the incisal or occlusal third of the tooth, supporting apparatus of the teeth like periodontium, various muscles of mastication which give motion to this entire apparatus, temporomandibular joint, soft tissues around the teeth like tongue and cheeks which are helpful in keeping the food to be masticated among the presentation. Lastly, the neuromuscular control which controls the entire thing. Now, occlusion, actually it is, why it is considered so difficult, because it involves two characteristics. That is, occlusion is relationship between upper and lower teeth in two different types. That is, static, when they are completely occluded with each other, and the second one is functional, when the lower jaw is moving. So, now, coming to the point, why we need the occlusion. Now, for this, there are two tasks, primary task and secondary task. Primary task, as we all know, is the very most important thing, is mastication. Occlusion is there, so the it is needed to crush the food into a tiny particle so that it could be digested by the GI system. Another important primary task of occlusion is to maintain the vertical dimension. Now, vertical dimension, in short to explain, is the optimum distance between the mandible and the maxilla. You know that maxilla is a fixed jaw, mandible is moving. Now, why this optimum distance is important? This optimum distance is important because if this distance is not maintained, the muscles of mastication won't be able to generate the enough amount of contraction or pull to create the occlusal forces to crush the food. So that is why this proper vertical dimension is very, very important. It should not be more or it should not be less. In both the circumstances, it is going to cause pain or discomfort to the patient. Another primary task is enabling the speech or speech articulation. Without teeth, we all know that speech is very much, you can say, sort of fumbling. Now, you must have seen older individuals who are edentulous, not wearing any prosthesis. Whatever they speak, it is almost unable for us to understand it properly. We are not able to understand it clearly. So, why it is so? Because for to create a speech, we need the movement of the lower jaw, the associated structures and the teeth. For example, the anterior teeth are very important for, like, whenever you need to pronounce alveolar fricatives like S and Z, your tongue teeth will directly touch the lingual side of the upper anteriors. Similarly, there are certain fricatives which are referred as interdental fricatives, like words starting from O and D. So, in all these pronunciations of all these words, we need a interaction between the upper and lower teeth, which is made possible by this inclusion. Then, historically, occlusion is again important because teeth were often considered for our ancestors, teeth were often considered as a third hand or a tool. You know that especially the anterior teeth, because of their shovel shape anatomy, they are more like, they can be used like a sharp weapon. Now, there are secondary tasks like aesthetics and cosmetics. Now, you must have heard about that golden triangle principle. Golden, all our face or any beautiful looking structure, it has a particular golden proportion. Same thing is applicable to our face also. If you count the facial height from the glabella to the nose tip, it is around 2/3, and from the nose tip to the chin, it is around 1/3. So, occlusion maintains this lower part of that height of the face. If it alters by just 1 or 2 millimeter, it is going to cause alteration in appearance of that particular face. Now, there are certain ideal requirements for the occlusion. Now, in short, I will tell you what are these ideal requirements. The first ideal requirement is stable contact. Now, stable contract segment would be able to match it only when the lower tail contacts the upper tooth in a stable group. So, the first and most important requirement is having a proper stable point contact. On an average, a person with having has around 138 contact points between the upper and lower teeth. Okay. Another important ideal requirement is to transmit the forces, occlusal forces, along the long axis of the teeth. Now, this is particularly important for the posterior teeth, as it cannot, as it is not always possible for the anterior teeth, like the maxillary anterior. Why? Because maxillary anteriors, they are proclined. But for all other teeth, the occlusal forces have to be transmitted along the long axis of the teeth. If these forces are not transmitted along the long axis, if they are applied laterally, then it is very detrimental to the tooth itself. Either the tooth will get fractured, or more commonly, it is going to result in the loss of periodontium or the tooth support because of the laterally directed forces. Now, the last ideal requirement is the maxillary arch should always overhang the mandibular arch. Now, why this is important? Because maxillary arch is fixed, whereas the mandibular arch is moving. So, why it has to overhang, especially on the buccal aspect, is so whenever we bite, whenever the mandible strikes against the mandibula, the force generated is so high that if the maxillary overhang is not there, the mandible will just slip off from the maxillary arch. And this won't allow the proper mastication of the tooth. For this, our maxillary teeth, they are usually placed more buccally as compared to the mandibular teeth. So, whenever the mandible strikes, the mandible doesn't get deflected, rather than it gets stuck in between the maxillary. Apart from this, it also protects the surrounding soft tissues from coming in between the teeth while the mastication. Now, you can see in the picture on your left side is how the normal overhang should be, whereas the picture on your right side is an abnormal overhang in which the mandibular teeth are having overhang over the maxillary teeth. Okay. Now, most important part of this topic is what are the factors which affect occlusion. Now, this particular part is very simple. The only one thing is we have to divide it into three phases. Remember that our dentition goes through various phases like the primary dentition, mixed dentition and then the permanent dentition. So, the development of occlusion for permanent dentition, is completely dependent how the occlusion was in the deciduous and mixed dentition. Okay? So, to study and understand the occlusion at the permanent dentition level, we should know how it is at the deciduous and mixed dentition level. So, for this, we can divide it, the factors which have an impact on occlusion in permanent dentition can be divided under this heading. The first is how it develops, that is the development in the primary and mixed dentition, the dental arch, shape and form, various compensating curves, angulations of the teeth, the functional form of the teeth, that is at the incisor or occlusal third, or you can say incisor and occlusal surfaces. Then facial and lingual relationship of teeth in one arch with that of the tooth in the teeth in the antagonist arch. And the occlusal contacts of upper and lower teeth in centric relation and occlusal contact of upper and lower teeth when the mandible is in various movements like the lateral or protrusion movements. Lastly, the neurobehavioral aspect of occlusion means how our central nervous system and other related structure control the movement of the mandible and thus the